Hello everyone, I am OL Kervodek and I am going to present our latest paper, Bounding Boxes for Weakly Supervised Segmentation. This presentation will be structured as follows. First, we'll discuss the inherent uncertainty of weak labels and the difficulties that it brings to supervised segmentation network. Then we'll discuss the tightness prior and how it can be applicable and useful in our context to use bounding boxes for image segmentation. We'll then discuss how to actually constrain a deep network during training, because this is not an easy task and cannot be solved trivially. And then we'll present our results and conclusion. So, to give an example of weak labels, in this case point annotation or bounding box annotation, let's compare to a ground truth. So when we have a complete ground truth annotation, we have information for each pixel. In that case, we know that all the blue pixels belong to the background and all the green pixels belong to the foreground. In the case of point annotation, we have this patch of green pixels that we know that belong to the foreground, and for the rest of the image, it is unknown. It could be background, it could be foreground, but we actually don't know. In the case of a bounding box, it is the opposite. We know where the object is not. So for all that blue part, we know this background. But inside the bounding box, we don't know which pixels belong to the object. Some of them will be pixel, some of them will be background, but we don't know which one. In a previous work of ours, we used point annotation with some prior size information. And to introduce the formulation of this presentation, theta is the network parameter that we are actually optimizing for. Omega is the image space, so the coordinates of all pixels. And omega L is a subset of omega, which contain only those labeled pixels. So in that case, all the green pixels and only those. P is a pixel. And SP of theta are the foreground probabilities, the softmax output of our neural network. So what we did in that work was to apply a usual cross entropy loss, but only on the pixels that have a label, which is not sufficient to train a network successfully. But at the same time, we were constraining its output so that the size of the predicted segmentation, so basically the sum of all the softmax probabilities over the whole image, and not just the label part, but the whole image. And we wanted this predicted size of the prediction to be between two values, A and B. So it worked quite well on different data sets, but it required some size information, and in the best setting, we needed the exact information for each image, which is actually not that realistic to get. It was interesting to see how far it could go, but we didn't have a realistic setting to get that information. Now let's say we had a bounding box annotation. It would give a natural upper bound to the size of the object, because the object cannot be bigger than the box containing it. And if we try to apply the exact same setting that we did, but with bounding box annotation, now we'll introduce the omega O set to define the outside of the box, and omega I for the inside of the box. The background probability is simply 1 minus the softmax. We just inverse the predicted probability. And what we could do to use the same setting would be to do the cross entropy for the background class on the outside of the box. And we could put the constraints on the size of the prediction to be less than the size of the box. But it doesn't work, and it wouldn't work for several reasons. The first is that it introduced quite a big imbalance between the size of the outside of the box, which is the majority of the image, and our actual foreground class. The other issue that we have is that there is no explicit supervision to predict the foreground. We explicitly supervise some pixels to be background. We put the limit on how big the foreground can get, but there is nothing pushing up some probabilities for some foreground pixels. So this ends up predicting only background. There will be some dirty solution for that. We could mix bounding box and points. to have different partial cross entropy, but then it actually gets close to what a real ground truth is. And the point is to reduce annotation tasks. So if we start doing several annotation per image, we lose a lot of interest in the method. We could have ugly heuristics. For instance, we can notice that on this dataset, probably that the middle of the box would belong to the object. So we could supervise some pixels around the middle of the box to belong to the object. But this is not very elegant. And on a lot of dataset and tasks where, for instance, the object is deformable, is soft, or each object is quite unique, for instance, in the case of brain lesions, this would not apply. One rule for one instance wouldn't work for another one. For instance, let's say we want to segment this camel in a bounding box. So depending on how the camel is standing, if it's sleeping, if it's eating something, it's the way it fills the box will be completely different, and we cannot have a rule that will match every box containing a camel. So this is where the tightness prior is coming to help and can be really useful. So the tightness prior, introduced by Lembinski at ICCV 2009, states that given a sufficiently tight bounding box, then any line parallel to the box edges, so any horizontal and vertical line, will have to cross the object at least at some point. We can see here easily, if we shifted those blue lines, we will keep crossing some part of the camel at some point. And this is the same for the vertical lines. And we can generalize this tightness prior to a segment of width W, which is a collection of W lines, then we'll cross the object at least W times. So we can write that in a bit more formal way. We can define big S L as a set of all the segments of a box, so all the horizontal segments and all the vertical segments. Small S L is a specific segment, so let's say this pink segment on the left, and W is its width. So YP is a binary label, the true label that we don't have but that we are looking for. And we know that for a fact, because of this tightness prior, that if we sum the true label over all the pixels in the segment, so over all the pink pixels, then that sum will be greater or equal to W. And this is true for all segments in our segment set. So we can use that to update the previous formation that we had. We'll note as LO, the loss for outside the box, how we supervise the pixels that we know to be background. We'll not detail now exactly how we actually do that. Those details are in the paper. And we still have the constraint on the overall size. So the total predicted size should still be smaller than the bounding box. But we can add a new series of constraints. So one constraint per segment in the segment set. And we replace the sum over the true label by the sum on the predicted probabilities. So we are forcing for each segment, we are forcing the sum of the probabilities to be greater or equal to W. So this formulation would work in theory. It has all the information that it needs for the network to learn how to segment an object. But we cannot do that directly. We end up with an optimization problem with dozens of constraints to satisfy, which are actually in competition. And recent works using, for instance, penalty methods or tweak Lagrangian methods are not able to optimize such a setting. They are either very unstable or just predict empty segmentation. So a recent work on extended log barrier proved to be much more robust and actually enabled the model that we are proposing. To give an overview of what is a log barrier and how we actually use it, let's say we want to optimize this very simple setting where we want to minimize L of X with respect to X, with a constraint that Z, which is a function of X, should be lesser or equal to 0. So a log barrier and or the extended log barrier will act as a function that we had into the loss function that we minimize. It has a parameter t, which is the slope of the barrier. So when z is over its bound, so when z is positive, there is a cost to pay. And by trying to minimize that cost, it will move z back into the feasible set where z is lesser or equal than 0. And so what we do is to schedule t to increase it over time to basically close that barrier. The cost is higher as higher, pushing more and more z into the feasible set. And the main difference with actually a barrier and a penalty is that there is already some cost to pay when we get near the border of the feasible set. So this allows to keep all the different competing constraints into satisfaction and prevent the network to go to become either unstable during training or to fall into trivial solutions. So by using the log barrier, we end up with this final model. We still have LO, which supervises the outside of the box. Then comes a series of log barrier functions, each of them for a specific segment of the bounding boxes, which will force the network to predict enough probabilities for that segment to be over W. And then we have this regularizing log barrier to put an upper bound on the size of the on the total size of the predicted segmentation. So this final model has two simple hyperparameters to tune. There is the weight lambda for the tightness prior, which will balance it with respect to the loss for the outside of the box. And we also have t, which is the slope of the log barrier, which we have to schedule to increase over time. But this is the same t for all instances of log barriers. There is no dedicated t for each constraint. So we evaluated our model on two different data sets, one prostate data set and a brain lesion data set. And we also compared to the state-of-the-art deep cut method. So when we take a look at the numbers, we see actually a small gap on the prostate data set, but already a much bigger one on the brain data set. And actually on that one, we are getting really close to full supervision, so cross entropy with a complete labeled image. What is interesting to notice is that if we use only the loss for the outside and the tightness prior, usually the network is not able to learn because it needs the regularizing property of the upper bound on the box size. What is also very interesting is if we actually take a look at the predicted segmentation, we can see that DeepCut and our proposed method were quite close on that prostate data set in numbers, but when we look visually at what it is predicting, we can see that DeepCut still tends to output something that looks like a box, whereas our method is able to fit much more nicely and deform to fit the edge of the object. So in conclusion, we showed that the tightness prior implemented as a series of constraints enable a direct use of bounding box compared to other methods that require either proposal generation, pre-processing, post-processing, and some regularizing heuristics. We are able to integrate it directly into any standard network training. So it's compatible with other losses, as you will see in the paper, and it could be we could keep adding other losses depending on the task. So there is more details in the paper about how we actually implement the loss for the outside. We also compare the computational cost of our method compared to standard training and to deep cut, and we show that we got a marginal increase. We also perform a tightness sensitivity to see how it behaves when we relax the tightness of the box. Our code is publicly available. You are free to check it out, to use it, and to try to reproduce our results or implement it, integrate it into your code. So we'll be able during the whole conference, we'll be available in the chat, but also on GitHub, and feel free to come up and ask questions.